that telephone prospecting is dead, that they everybody should focus on putting content marketing or social media marketing and all of that nonsense. And it's okay. You wanna attract high quality leads. That's what you teach. But at some point, you need to pick up the phone and talk to them.
I think even if I have people I tell, I'm on my soapbox every day. Pick up the phone, talk to 5 people a day. That's all I ask.
Yeah.
I will even in writing guarantee success to people if they speak to 5 people a day. Speak to 5 people a day. And they use the gut sales method. Two conditions. That's all I have. Speak to 5 people a day and use the gut sales method. If you can do those 2 things every day, I will guarantee in writing that anyone could make money. As long as they have an ethical, legal product, of course, real estate and whatever. But I don't think, this frustrates me because I love seeing people succeed. Why aren't people speaking? Where have we lost the skill for direct marketing, direct selling? In the old days, guys would knock on doors selling vacuum cleaners. What was it? Mary Kay would come to someone's house, do lipstick or
Avon or just like there's a bunch of stuff.
Avon. Tupperware used to. And these people made
Cutco knives. I mean, there's just a bunch of stuff.
I think even Anthony Robbins, if I'm not mistaken, used to door to door, used to sell something door to door. I forgot. And Zig Ziglar used to from Texas. He's gone. Great salesman. Good books, by the way. He used to sell pots and pans door to door. Okay. I mean, you knock on enough doors and you have all these pots and pans you're holding in a suit. Someone's going to say yes eventually, right?
Yeah. I mean, the way I see it is that there people have been given the wrong advice first because they told them that telephone prospecting is not needed, that, you know, like that there's other sources, like, I don't know, like just blasting people on social media or text or email spam, whatever you want to call it. And then for the ones that are teaching how to call people, they're teaching it the wrong way. It's just call a list of cold prospects. You know, just make 100 have 100 okay. conversations where you're gonna be treated very bad.
Well,
and, cold, and cold maybe you get lucky and you get one.
I mean, cold prospects are hard. Let's just break it down between warm, hot, and cold prospects. Most people do their marketing with cold prospects. They scrape a list. They buy a list, they have someone else filter the list and call up and make appointments. But, and those lists are based on some kind of mathematical formulation. They're behind in their payments. They have a lien on or a judgment on their property, or they bought a same or similar product that you're selling at one time. But so when you call these people up, and this is a cold call, they don't know you. And you don't have to talk to, mom said, don't talk to strangers. And if you're calling them up and you sound like every telemarketer that everybody gets every day, you're going to get 100% rejection. I exaggerate a little. It's probably 99%.
99.5%, just okay. to be generous.
And the other thing they do wrong. So that's cold marketing is hard. And when you and they're using a script, hi, just reaching out, how are you today, which they don't really mean. And then they go into their presentation. You're going to get 100% rejection like that. And this is the part that bothers me, because I believe most people are well-meaning. And when they make that phone call and they get the motivation speech from the guru, the seminar or whatever, the sales.
They're pumped, but then Monday comes.
Yeah. They're pumped. They make the phone calls. People hang up on them. They're nasty to them. They don't say Merry Christmas. They say something else. And and when you get that much rejection, you procrastinate. Oh, I better clean the bathroom. Oh,
you associate it with a negative emotion because that's what's causing you. That now you said 2 things that are very important. Speak to 5 people. Don't make 5 dials. Because it might take you 30 dials to speak to 5 people. But once you get them on the line, have a system, okay? And you also mentioned that cold prospecting is hard. At some point in time, especially when you're in an initial state, you're building up a business, you have to grind it. There's no shortcut. there's you know, like, it's hard work and traditionally doesn't yield results because people procrastinate or don't have a system. Now, if you absolutely need to do cold prospecting, you need to have the right tools. You need to right. sound different, and you need to, because otherwise you're going to get eaten alive. You'll be dead in the water. And let's say on a best case scenario, your rejection rate, I mean, on average in the industry, it's 99%. Like anybody that
has a- Excuse me for interrupting, but that, why would you do something where you have a 99% failure rate?
Definition of insanity.
Insanity.
It's because it's mm-hmm. yeah. It's what they tell them it works. It's crazy.
It'll work. Listen, you call and make 10,000 phone calls. Sooner or later, you're going to get a sweet old lady in Florida, and she's going to buy your 3-minute timer. Okay, that's fine. But you're going to be exhausted. You're going to be emotionally drained and frustrated, and you're not going to make enough money for all that hard work and rejection. That's the way I look at it. I try to be as honest as possible. I love sales, and I've been in sales all my life. So here's my conclusion or premise. Why don't we just speak to warm prospects? We can become better at cold calling. And you know, part of the gut sales method is to convert people and engage them in a conversation. But even with my system, a cold call is much harder than a warm call, obviously.
So there's no way around it. There's no magic to it.
So why don't we focus? First of all, why don't we focus on generating more warm leads? You know, I'm big on attraction marketing, warm leads. You don't need a guru to tell you.
I'm gonna be vulnerable here, because when you focus on attracting quality leads, it means that you need to put yourself out there in front of the world. And that means that you have to put quality content out there. So you have to be consistent. You have to, you know, engage. You have to go on social media, record videos, whatever. Do whatever it takes because I mean, like you said, most people are well-meaning. They're great people that they have a quality product that they want to put out there in the world. And it's our responsibility to tell the world about it. But at the same time, everybody's insecure. So people are just more worried about, like, get it perfect than just do it. Oh, you know what? I'm going to record videos when I get a better camera. And this is a true story. Like that was me a couple of years ago. I'm going to record a video, or I'm going to write a script about something I should say.
I got to get a green screen.
Exactly. And instead of just doing it because it's just the same with the phone calls. It's the same with the phone calls. You just go ahead and do it, and you build a habit, and little by little, it becomes who you are. Like, for example, in your case, like, you go ahead and shoot 10 videos in one day, sometimes maybe more, because it's who you are. It's already in.
It's easy. It's fun. Yeah. It's actually fun. Or I'll do one a day. I'll put out my videos. I do public speaking too, by the way. I just got invited for a big speaking gig for next year. I do a lot of public speaking gigs. Guess what happens if I speak to 15 people in a church or 1,000 people at a real estate club? Guess what happens the next day?
You get warm, quality leads, inbound people that see the value.
I have a question. I have a deal. Boom, they contact me. Do you know how much I love when the prospect contacts me? You don't have to, you know, it's so much easier. Now, that's number one. You've got to have, and this is a good topic. Why do salespeople fail? First of all, they're working too hard, and they need better quality, warm leads. Okay. Yeah. And you don't have to spend a fortune for doing that. Number two, you better have a sales system so that you understand. My big word today is empathy. What are they thinking? What are they feeling? Can you anticipate? Do most people ask the same questions and have the same or similar feelings about your product or service? Yeah.
And that's a very, very good word, because empathy, most people got it confused with sympathy. Sympathy, it's feeling sorry or feeling bad for them. Empathy, it's understanding them and putting yourselves in their shoes.
Exactly. So you have warm leads, or better quality leads. Okay. They know who you are. they expected your call. They chased you for your information, or they wanted something for free. You created incentive. This is attraction marketing I always talk about. Gut sales method, 3 steps, question-based, redirection, stroking, nurturing, and a lot of empathy. I understand how you feel, sir. It's okay to say no to me, but you still have the problem. Is it the money issue? Because maybe we can work something out and you can eliminate that problem.
Let me ask you this. If money wasn't an issue, you wouldn't want to work with me.
Yeah, exactly. You? And then consistency in speaking to people directly every day. Can you speak to 2-3 people a day for your, I mean, unless you're selling toothbrushes or something, but most of my clients are people who sell capital goods, high priced products and programs and real estate, $1 million insurance policies, things like that. Most of my clients, the people who want to learn and make more money, are in capital sales, large dollar amount sales.
High ticket sales.
High ticket. Thank you. Better said.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah.
So can you do those 3 things? Marketing, learn sales, learn how to ask question-based selling, which is so essential, and it's so much easier. And can you have a consistent behavior so that you speak to enough people, you make enough offer? Every day I make offers. Every day I make offers. A lot of people, it's okay to say no to me. Well, Claude, call me after New Year's. No, sir. My offer is off the table at 6.
You're about to put the lottery ticket in the shredder.
That's it. Assertiveness and not only empathy, understanding how they're thinking and feeling, but you got to be on. I think you got to be very honest with yourself. I don't think we're honest with ourselves. I think we live in this little dream world. Oh, Claude, I talk to people. Claude, I'm going to make $1 million a month, you know, or 100,000 a month and everything. Well, how much are you making now?
How?
Well, nothing. I'm on unemployment. Well, what are you radically going to change in your behavior, your character, your work ethic? Okay, I heard something. I'll get a little slightly political here. I never do that. I heard on the news today, they had a big discussion about people aren't going back to work. That's why restaurants.
It's easier to collect, but now they're, you know, but like
collect the, what, Felipe? Tell me, what do they collect? Shit.
They collect nothing. They collect, you know, like it's just like they got used. It's like it's so hard to build a good habit, but it's so easy to lose it. It's like, for example, eating right, exercising. Like people lost the habit of working. Like if you ask like the what they call it, the greatest generation, the people that built this country after World War II, they will be sick of watching this generation. I had word of honor, I had a conversation with my wife yesterday and watching the kids. I have 3 kids and us, we are raising the worst generation in human mankind.
I'll tell you what though, I'll take exception because your kids will do great because you and your wife are excellent role models. My kids are doing great right now. My kids are adults and they're doing really great. They're great kids. I'm so proud of them. And my kids are self-sufficient and your kids are going to be the same way. I'm the son of immigrants. Immigrants work 10 times harder than anyone else because they're so grateful.
Absolutely. No, but I mean, and I appreciate that, but the thing is, like, as a whole, as a society, we're raising the kids on entitlement, on that belief that the world owes them something when it's not like that. And it's not that the world is a bad place or like people are against them or after them. It's that, you know, they need to understand that they need to become self-sufficient.
What's going to happen is we're going to have people who work, who want a good lifestyle, who want to be independent and free. If they need something, the money's there. They get better health care because they can afford it. They eat better food. They live in nicer places. They're working harder and they don't have a feeling of entitlement. Then you have other people who are going to accept mediocre. Oh boy, this is so political. I'm going to get in trouble. They're going to accept the mediocrity as a lifestyle. And so you're not going to have a middle class anymore. This country was built on a strong middle class. Yeah. And we're to set the middle class is going to be, it's going to be upper middle class and wealthy people and a hell of a lot of poor people. And
you know what that can, and you know, what you're mentioning, it's spot on, because if you have one part of society that that, you know, like it's going to be less than 20% of people, upper middle class, you know, high class people that, you know, that we believe in entrepreneurship, on the value of hard work, capitalism, all of the good things here. And then you're going to have this huge mass of people that, you know, like they're accepting mediocrity. At some point, this, yeah, the bullfucking horse, like the, no, at some point that's gonna create social unrest and watch. I mean, like this is,
we're seeing it.
I mean, over the next couple of years, yeah, we're gonna see some nasty shit happening over the next couple of years because it's,
and what's happening right now to people who can afford to move out of the cities where there's social unrest, the Portlands, the New Yorks, Chicago has a horrible crime rate right now. Horrible.
Yeah.
Where, what people who can afford it, what are they doing? They're moving.
Yeah. They're just, I mean, if you're like, I mean, for real, like, would you rather be, you know, like in between gang wars and in LA, or just grab your stuff and go to a nice place, let's say Colorado or somewhere in Texas close to, like, you know, like, or Florida.
Yeah.
Where,
and yeah, you're seeing that culture shift right now that people can afford it. I have friends who have left California. They have moved to Idaho, Montana, Colorado, where I am right now. Country towns in North Carolina, like Pinehurst, where I've been the last six, you know, you're going to see it because people can work from home. The technology makes it for people who have the work ethic and who have the skill sets. They can live wherever they want, and they're doing it right now.
Yeah. 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 I mean, it's, I mean, it makes sense, especially like for raising a family. I mean, for us, it's like, we're seriously considering, not leave Florida, but just go to a safer place.
Florida is booming, right? I mean, Florida is Mecca right now.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Florida is just, they're doing something right in Florida and in Texas, and some other states too, where they're less government, less regulations, kind of, people are prospering in these places.
Yeah. Here we're being able to do evictions in less than 60 days. It's been, things work. And in Texas is even better. Actually, we just did an expansion to, started doing land, because land is dirt cheap in the surrounding counties to Travis County, where Austin is, because that's where they're going to put the Tesla factory. Is going to go there.
Oh, in Austin?
In the counties below Travis County. So I heard that.
Austin has no inventory at all. It is so popular.
It's sick. It's sick. It's like San Diego. It's like almost like San Diego. It's like 700 and up. $1,000 per home. It's crazy.
That is crazy. So we're seeing a culture shift right now going into 2022. Are you as concerned as I am about this inflation and high unemployment and lack of production? You can't buy a car. You can't. There's no cars available right now to buy.
Goodness.
Is that crazy?
We got. We trade in the Pilot, and the reason why is because I wasn't looking to change the car, but a friend of mine upgraded to a Volvo, and they're very safe.
But I still love Honda. I'm a Honda fan.
Me too. My wife was actually, she was grieving when she was trading it in, but they just made it so easy. It was a no-brainer because, like, the trade-in was probably $3,000 more than what we would have gotten, like, in a regular situation. It got it to $6,000 more than what we could have gotten.
Mm-hmm.
And then the monthly payment is just, we looked at a lease and financing. It was just pretty much the same, like, it made perfect sense for a new car, safer car.
Yeah. So, Volvo is a very good car. It's a popular car here in the mountains. Colorado. Volvo.
All-wheel drive.
Oh yeah. Yeah. I have a Cadillac XT8. It's fantastic in the snow. When you live in a place that gets 300 or more inches of snow in a winter, you better have a good four-wheel drive or all-wheel drive car. Absolutely. So what do you see for 2022?
My forecast is that I really hope not, but what we talked about at the end of 2020, but it's probably going to happen. We will see a correction on the real estate market. Finally, There's going to be some kind of correction. I really hope not, but we might be seeing some hyperinflation happening. And
it's almost 7% now.
Yeah, but when you get to double digits, it gets scary. It gets scary because it means that whatever money you have in the bank, it's worth less and less every day. And that's going to, you know, like when that happens, people, you know, like take their money out of the bank and they just put it in other stuff. And what's the best thing to put it? It's in real estate. You know, like
real estate is on a long-term basis is the best investment you'll ever make. Right now, the way I see it, interest rates are going to adjust soon. Inflation is going to, I hope I'm wrong. I think it's going to go to double digits. Do you ever go shopping with your wife?
Yeah. I mean, and it's everything. There's also the supply chain. It's still affected because I know people that are in import export. The cost of a 40-foot container used to be $2,500 2 years ago before COVID. Now it's up to $25,000.
That's nuts.
And that.